Could you tell us a little bit more about what a meaningful vote for Parliament would look like at the end of the Article 50 negotiations? Would it be a vote on a simple resolution? And how at that stage could it be other than a take it or leave it kind of vote?
Well, if you have Parliament being able to consider the draft deal, so not after it's been signed between the United Kingdom government and the 27, and a chance to scrutinise it, in the same way that the European Parliament is going to have the opportunity to do this. That's why it was always fanciful for the government to have resisted the idea we were going to have a vote here when the European Parliament was going to have a vote. Well, what was all that about? When you thought about it, it wasn't a position that was going to be capable of holding. And in due course, it fell apart and the government agreed to that. So you have a chance to scrutinise it. And as Bronwyn said a moment ago, you could say, well, that's wonderful. Yep, we'll take that. Or you could say, well, that's all terrific, but I'm afraid this bit isn't really good enough. Can you go and try and get something better here? Now, that all of this depends on what the 27 are going to have to say. So that's the first element of it. And the second element of it is, what do we do if there is no deal? Now, the argument will be made in Parliament this week that in those circumstances, the idea that the government would say, I'm really sorry, we haven't been able to reach a deal, right, we're leaving, and that's it, and nothing to do with you, Parliament. Well, I don't think that is a viable option either. Parliament, in those circumstances, would have to consider, well, what are we going to do? Now, the options are difficult, because you either extend the period or ask to extend the period of the negotiation. But that depends on the 27 member states saying, OK, let's talk a bit more. Who knows? It depends what circumstances we found ourselves in. But the clock has started ticking, and we are going to be leaving the European Union. But what the referendum decided was the fact we're leaving the institutions, that's clear. What it didn't determine is the terms on which we live and the basis on which we establish a new relationship. Because all of these questions about trade and movement of people and cooperation on foreign policy, defence, security, the fight against terrorism, the position of EU nationals here, Brits abroad, all of those are up for negotiation. And I think that amendment is Parliament seeking to say to government, we want to be involved in this process and not just say, right, off you go, and whatever you agree, you don't have to come back and ask us. Because what is Parliament for in the single most important set of decisions we face for decades? We're not going to sit on the sidelines. And that, I think, is the spirit behind the amendment. Yeah, that's, I think, what we're hoping to achieve in the course of this week. And it depends if we can get sufficient votes to back it. I hope we will, but I don't know.
Thanks.
Yep.
Thanks. Does it here?
Miranda Curtis, I'm a trustee here at the Institute for Government.
Hi.
My experience from the world of international corporate negotiations is that some of the key challenges actually arise not so much at the end of the process, but at the very beginning. And the question that I'm interested in is, what happens when Mrs. May and her team sit down at the beginning of the negotiations and our European counterparties say, Mrs. May, we understand you have a mandate to negotiate, but do you have a mandate for the negotiating positions that you are outlining? And can you demonstrate that you have the support not only of Parliament, but of the business community for the positions that you want to negotiate with us?
I think it'd be a bit cheeky if the 27 were to do that, really. What?
Perfectly normal in negotiations.
I think for Angela Merkel to look at Theresa May and say, well, please prove to me that you have support for the propositions you're putting. You deal government to government. The government set out what its negotiating objectives are. I think if the 27 were to attempt to get into second-guessing the position the British government has put forward, well, I really don't see that happening. I'm sorry. I don't see that happening at all. The 27 are going to have to take what the British government is asking for at face value and respond accordingly. But as they've made it clear, they're not terribly keen on cherry picking. And as the Prime Minister of Malta was saying only recently, as plenty of others have said, you are absolutely not going to have a better deal as you leave than you had when you were in. And that's, well, they would say that, wouldn't they? And they are fearful, of course, of contagion, because other EU countries might say, well, that sounds pretty good, can I have one of those too? So I don't worry about. I think it's going to be quite interesting to see how the 27 agree, a common negotiator. I would have thought that's a bigger challenge for them, not second-guessing what the British government says, but working out what the attitude of the 27 is going to be to the set of demands and requests that we have made. And the other most important thing at the start of the negotiation will be, in what order are we going to do this? That's the single most important thing. Because if you don't get the order right, the chance of doing the framework bit in the time available are pretty low, I would say.
Do you want to come back on that at all?
No, please. I mean, that's okay. No, fine.
All right. There's an interesting, much longer debate we could have on that. Over here, please.
Thanks. I'm Alex Carlisle. I'm now a non-affiliated member of the House of Lords, formerly a Liberal Democrat. You, Hilary, and indeed notably Sir Keir Starmer, have put forward a very coherent argument for the current stage in the last few days and this morning. But I remain a perplexed parliamentarian who has to decide what to do in a couple of weeks' time, when this matter is debated in the House of Lords, where the government may not win. And the reason I'm perplexed is, supposing we do as you suggest, and I'm inclined to do so, which is support the triggering of Article 50, what is the role of Parliament at a later stage if the agreement that is reached is plainly contrary to the national interest in the opinion of MPs and members of the House of Lords? What is the status of our vote? What can we do? And I think what I'm asking is really for your committee to set out a programme that MPs and peers will understand, because many of us are very confused as to our role in the next couple of years.
Thanks for the question, Alex. I think, first of all, us all being clear, it's the phrase I used earlier, that we are not bystanders, but we are participants, and we're determined to be so, and persuading the government that they should embrace that, because it comes back to your question, which is a fair point. In this sense, I think it strengthens the government's position negotiating on behalf of the nation if it's clear that they have the support of Parliament and the business community behind them. Now, for tariff and barrier-free trade, we're all supporting that. Now, there's an argument about the single market, and there's certainly an argument about the customs union for the reasons I set out earlier. So that's the first point. The second is, one has to recognise the decision has been made by the British people. That was the basis of the referendum. Now, I know there's a lot of argument about this, and it is difficult for colleagues who represent heavily Remain seats, and I absolutely respect people who've made their own judgment to vote against the bill for that reason. But that isn't the issue at debate anymore. And I just make this other observation. I think it's very important. We have a bit of a crisis of confidence in our political system, right? Here in Britain, in America, clearly in Europe. Pause for a moment and just think what a crisis we would have in our democracy if Parliament were to turn round and say, actually, we really don't think you knew what you were doing, and we know better than you. Now, I think that would be profoundly damaging, not to say dangerous, and that is part of the reason, respecting the referendum, why the House of Commons, and certainly on the Labour side, you saw such a large majority in favour of passing the bill. And I've said, but you'll know much better than I, that I think the House of Lords will do the same, because I don't think that is a place that the House of Lords would want to go, for a host of reasons. Although if a government would turn around and say, right, you're trying to block it, we'll have an election, and one of our manifesto commitments will be to replace the current second chamber. Well, actually, I'd be in favour of having an elected second chamber, but that's a separate matter which doesn't necessarily need to arise because of Brexit. Whether that would be an added bonus, I don't know. We'll leave that on one side.
Thanks for that improvisation.
I don't think we will end up there, because I'm assuming that a majority of peers will in the end vote the legislation through. But this question of the vote, and the answer I tried to give to your question earlier, I think that's the most important bit of it, because it enables you as a parliamentarian and others of us in the room to say, right, we're starting the process, but we are going to come back to look at this at the end of it and see where we are and what we have got in the context of us leaving. But it means that we're not just now going to be bystanders as the government goes off and agrees, and the other 27 consent to agree to whatever it is they decide to put on a piece of paper when they've finished. So that's why that amendment is so important this week.
Thank you. At the back, sort of at the back. Yes, there, yes, and then I'll come to the front here.
I'm Tony Barber from the Financial Times. I wondered if you could address what looks like a potential contradiction in the British negotiating position here. On the one hand, it seems that the desire to get the best possible outcome for the country might tempt the government to try and drive wedges between individual governments among the 27. Yet, in the longer term, it would seem to be in the British interest to have a more cohesive and stable 27, because we don't want instability so close to our own borders. Do you see any sort of contradiction there?
The first thing I'd say is it's absolutely in the British national interest that the European Union, after we've gone, continues to thrive, to work together and to be a strong force. And one of the reasons I'm so passionate about finding a creative way of maintaining cooperation on foreign policy, defence, security, the fight against terrorism, is I don't want Europe's position as a geographical entity, we're leaving the institutions, we're not leaving Europe, to be weakened, because I think that's very important in, as you alluded to Bronwyn earlier, an unstable and an uncertain world. So that is clearly in our own interest to carry that on. Secondly, it depends what kind of deal we're talking about. Because, of course, at the moment, the deal envisaged by Article 50 requires QMV on the Council and the consent of the European Parliament. If there is a more substantial comprehensive free trade agreement, which then tips over into what is described as a mixed agreement, and I know lawyers and others argue over where is the tipping point between one and the other, if you ended up with a mixed agreement, then as you know, you would require the consent of every member state, including the Parliament of Wallonia. So it's more than just 27 parliaments and the European Parliament as well. Now that would change the calculation, because clearly you would need every single member state, whereas in the case of QMV, you don't require the agreement of every single member state. And I don't think we should, and I don't think we will be setting out to divide and rule amongst the 27, but they are going to have different interests, as your question implies, and therefore the challenge for them is going to be able to reach agreement on what their negotiating position is. And they will no doubt be chewing over what they've read in the white paper, what the Prime Minister said in her speech, and deciding what approach that they are going to take. So, for example, on free movement, different countries clearly have different interests, A, in relation to the 3 million who are here. Now, the government has said a couple of times, almost all the member states, the 27, are up for a deal, apart from one or two. David Davis has said that in the House now. I don't know if anyone in the room knows who the one or two are, but we need to get those one or two on board, because the lack of certainty, as you all know, is a big issue for EU citizens who are here and for the Brits abroad. We've taken evidence from both before the Select Committee and the Brits abroad. Pensioners retired in Spain, what's going to happen to my health care? People who are citizens of one country, married somebody else, were they here exercising their free movement rights or not? Because this is all about people's lives and their relationships and their stories. And getting that sorted, it really is in our interest to get agreement with the 27, because I hope that's the first thing that can be agreed when the negotiations begin. It's in everybody's interest that we should do that.
You say you want it to be the first thing, but you could see just that point of controls on immigration and free movement and so on taking a very long time. As you said, the 27 are not agreed. It's going to take quite a bit to get them agreed, if they do. And European internal European negotiations can, as we know, go on for many, many years.
Well, if the Prime Minister had said, I am going to take my wish to control EU migration into negotiations about our place in the single market, then it would have been the subject of negotiation. But the government's position is to say, we're not even going to have that conversation because we're leaving the single market. We're going to determine our immigration control in relation to the EU. That's not going to be part of the talks, apart from indicating this is the general approach we're thinking of taking. But the government will not be asking for Europe's blessing or consent to our future immigration policy once we've left, because that will be entirely a matter for us to determine legally, because free movement leaves once we've left. Free movement ends once we've left. But indicating the broad approach that the government intends to take to that could have an impact on the atmosphere of goodwill in the negotiations, I think.
Here, towards the front. Sorry, I was meaning a bit further forward. Is that someone very patient here? Yes.
Hi, good morning. I'm morning. Adam Sharples, former civil servant. I'm rather pleased I'm not still a civil servant.
You might get called back, you know.
Not after this.
Yeah, all right.
You start off by saying that no deal would be the worst deal of all.
Yeah.
And I agree. You describe a negotiating process of horrendous complexity, both in terms of the subject matter, the timetable, and the decision-making process in the end game. And so my question is, how can it be responsible for the opposition to support the triggering of Article 50, the lighting of the fuse with a fixed length, when so little work has been done on defining positions, clarifying positions, and even understanding what we want out of that endgame?
Well, I suppose there's two answers to that. One is, I mean, it was the Prime Minister who determined that she wanted to trigger Article 50 by the end of March. And the decision that we are leaving, now I realise your question is about timing, but the whole politics of this country has, post the referendum, has divided between you're trying to block the decision of the British people that we're going to leave, and the argument that you yourself have raised. Are we going to be, if you left it another year, 2 years, are we going to be in a better position to start the negotiations? I don't know. I mean, that's, the government has clearly decided they think they can do it by the end of March. And I come back to the answer I gave earlier to Alex about confidence in our politics. And I think that that is an important consideration. And I don't think it'd be right, in the circumstances we're in, for the opposition to say, no, we're not going to agree with it, even given where we are. Because would we really be in a much better position in a year's time? Now, you may think we would. I don't know. But I'm not party to the work that the government has done and their degree of readiness for the task they're about to embark upon. Now, the one potential safety valve is if there is agreement of all of the parties, then actually 2 years was impossibly short, and therefore it might take a bit longer to negotiate the deal. So there is that available, but that is not in our hands, because it's also in the hands of the 27 member states. And I don't know what decision they would reach. I think it might partly depend on where the negotiations have got to. And obviously the 2 years will concentrate the minds as to the speed with which people negotiate, I hope, certainly on our side, and I hope the same is true for the 27.
Thank you. Suddenly loads of hands going up. All right, the next in order was over by the fireplace, and then I'll come over here and here.
Hi, I'm Mark McClelland, Head of Research at Dodds Group. You're an early supporter of sort of transitional arrangements. What do you make of those, primarily on the Brexit side, who argue that the transitional arrangements are no easier to come to agreement with the 27 than a long-term comprehensive arrangement?
Well, I don't think it's a competition between the two, because if you are able to agree a new relationship, then in any deal, I mean, with trade agreements, it's extremely common, okay, how are we going to get from where we are to where we need to be? Now, it depends on the degree of change that the new arrangements represent compared with the existing arrangements. But businesses would say to you, if there is going to be a change, I need to change my IT system. I need to sort out my paperwork. The HMRC will undoubtedly, if we came out on WTO terms, they're going to have to employ quite a lot of people at Dover and Felixstowe to check stuff that they don't have to check at the moment. It's really quite basic. And how long is it going to take them to recruit and train and so on and so forth? So it is entirely common sense to say where there are going to be changes between the world as we know it now and the world as it's going to be, you give people time to adjust. It's particularly important for small and medium-sized enterprises, including those who are at the cutting edge of our economy, who will be helping to generate the wealth of the future. Because the challenge for us is, how do we maintain our position as the sixth strongest economy in the world? And how have we made the transition over 50 years from when steel, shipbuilding, textiles, manufacturing employed huge numbers of people in this country, and they don't employ huge numbers of people in this country anymore? And 50, 60 years ago, if you said, I've been to 2017, you know, all those people who work in these industries now, they're not going to be working there in 2017. 60 years ago, would have said, well, we'll be sunk as a nation. Now, we're not, because we have replaced those jobs with new industries, new services, a whole load of things that are important to our economy. 80% of our economy is services. And that is why we have to have regard to that ecosystem of business and the way it works, and make sure if there is going to be a change in trading relationships, we give people time to adjust. Because Europe remains, of course, our largest single export market, and it's very important to the services industry as well. So I don't think it's a contradiction between the two. You need a deal and you need sensible transitional arrangements. And I'm glad we got to the point where the government is saying that they will seek it.
Great. Here on the aisle.
Thank you. I'm Ken Bluestone from Age International. You touched on the fact that part of the backdrop to these discussions is a broader dissatisfaction and criticism of internationalism that's going on, not just here, but in other parts of the world as well. And I just wanted to get a sense from you, how significant do you think this is actually for success in what we try to achieve from exiting the European Union? What role, if any, does Parliament have to play in that?
I think it's the most important question of all. Now, we have an occupant in the White House who seems particularly unenamored of the international rules-based system that we created after the end of the Second World War. And I was much struck, I think it was 3 weeks before the referendum, Jean-Claude Juncker made a speech in which, I think he used his words, he said, perhaps we have interfered a bit too much in people's lives. Now, I thought it was an interesting observation to make, maybe a tad on the late side, given that the referendum had been going on. And we always had a slightly different relationship because we weren't in Schengen, we weren't in the Euro. Boy, was that a sensible decision, right? And I think it's about balance, actually. Now, in life, in politics, in everything, you need to find the right balance. And what I think Brexit has done is to sort of shift the fulcrum a bit, but we need to make sure that things are in balance subsequent to this. And that's why I made the point earlier that I feel that Europe should reflect upon that. Because I'm a passionate advocate of devolution in the UK, particularly for England. We've remained a very, very centralised country. I want more powers for the lead city region on transport, skills, housing, all of these things, because I think we could do a better job in deciding what the priorities are than excellent civil servants in Whitehall. For transport schemes, why do they make the journey down to the Department of Transport to be vetted and prioritised? Actually, we know what the priorities are. If you give us the cash, we'll decide what the priorities are, and you can keep the rest for really big transport schemes that are national. Now, that would be a sensible arrangement. And I think this control was the word of the referendum. Let's be honest about this. On free movement, lots of people said to me, look, I'm voting leave. I'm not arguing, they would say, that there should be no migration to this country. Of course we're going to need continuing migration. I just want to have some control over it. And the same is true in the thirst for devolution of power, because it's about trying to make sense of a world which is changing, and changing very fast in many ways. And I think it's something that we should recognise and embrace, because if you don't understand that, then other people come along, as politics around the world demonstrate, particularly when times are hard, people have seen their income stagnate, the continuing effects of the crash, old industries have disappeared, old ways of life have gone, people think we're not being listened to. I had a lot of constituents who do not vote in general elections who came out and voted in this referendum, and they would say, we didn't think you were listening to us. And if they were in this room today, they'd look at you and me and they'd say, you're listening now, aren't you? And for them, it was a moment to express political power. And we have to acknowledge that. We have to acknowledge that. I think it's really, really important. Because if you don't, then we're going to find it difficult to win our way through.
All right, we're coming to the end. Let me squeeze in the two questions.
Yeah, sure.
I've been very, very patient. Let's take them together, though, if you'll forgive me. Here on the aisle, and then down over there.
Of course.
Hi, Adam Penn from Business Insider. You've spoken about the importance of goodwill between ourselves and the European Union.
Yeah.
How do you think the government, particularly senior ministers within the government, in light of what we've said and how they've conducted themselves, have gone about maintaining and creating goodwill?
Yeah.
Great. Okay. And then over at the edge.
Hi, Tim Hughes, Director of Involve. You've spoken about the role of your committee in engaging with business and the devolved nations. You've also alluded to the decline in trust and sense that people aren't being listened to. So I was wondering what you see as the role of your committee over the coming years in engaging the general public.
Well, just to answer the last question first, please submit evidence. Actually, the last thing we did last Thursday is we had a round table which had been advertised in Boston, people from community organisations, from local community groups, from the local authority, and we sat in a series of tables, and they were absolutely frank in what they had to say about what impact, in particular, the change that Boston had seen. You know, Boston, its population went up from 55 to 65,000 people in 10 years. Many would argue that the 2011 census didn't really count all of the people who were living in the area. That's been important to the economy. It's a really big change in a place that hadn't changed enormously in the previous, 500. And they were very frank about that. Now, a lot of those views expressed, we as politicians on both sides of the referendum campaign were heard in loads of conversations during the course of the campaign. You couldn't campaign without hearing them, and our job is to listen, and politicians actually spend a lot of their time listening. And I would just encourage people to get involved in the debate, and if you've got a view about what needs to happen, make sure government knows what that is, because they have a very difficult task to rank in order of priority all of the wishes and demands of different sectors of the economy, different areas of national life. But if you don't shout about what it is that's important to you, then the government isn't going to hear it. So seize the moment. I think coming back to your question, well, it's been a bit of a mixed picture. When I reflect back to a certain week in Birmingham in the autumn where people of a particular political party gathered and made speeches, I would just say I thought that was a disastrous week for Britain's reputation in the world. Absolutely disastrous, because to produce headlines that says crack down on foreign students. Now, when I last checked, I wasn't aware that foreign students were a problem that we needed to crack down upon. Indeed, it's ridiculous to have overseas students in the net migration target. Absolutely absurd. Saying that doctors who've brought their skills to this country could stay in the interim while we train more of our own doctors. Well, great, let's train more of our own doctors, but we're going to continue to rely on people who brought their medical expertise from all over the world, for crying out loud. I just think it sent a message at that point that, well, we're closing in on ourselves as a nation, and that is not who we are. It's not what Britain is. And we thrive, we prosper, we succeed in the future by being an open and a welcoming nation. I think that's really, really important. And I think the second difficulty has been a little too much, we're going to get the following. Well, the 27 may be sitting there thinking, we'll see about that. And more recently, maybe the tone has changed a little bit. I think it would be prudent to change the tone because, as I said right at the beginning, what we get will depend, yes, on what we seek, the degree to which we're willing to compromise. Ultimately, it's going to be determined by what the 27 are also prepared to agree. And I think you've got to approach these negotiations in the right spirit, in the right atmosphere, and say, the British people made their decision, and there's no point in going back over that now. How can we get a deal that works for both of us? Because a bad deal for us may well be a bad deal for you. Now, let's find a way of working through, recognising we're not going to be able to walk away with everything we had before. We know that because we're the ones who are leaving. Now let's do it in the right spirit and let's see how we can continue to work together on loads of other things where we don't have to walk away from each other because it is in our shared national interest. And that's where the creativity is required, particularly on defence, foreign policy, security and the fight against terrorism. Because I didn't meet a single person in the referendum who said, I'm voting leave because I don't think we should be working with our European neighbours on those issues. We need to work even more closely with them in future, don't we?
Let me just ask you in conclusion, which I was going to ask you anyway, but follows directly from that last answer, whether you have a sense yourself of what a healthy net migration target might be.
I'm sure we've, yeah, no, no, we've... as you heard me say, I don't think the net migration target is it's certainly not a sensible measure in the way in which it is. I think the reason, I come back to the point I made about control. Because free movement, we have operated free movement in the most generous, open way mm-hmm. of any European country. And it says a lot about the strength of our economy, the jobs we've created, and the fact that people like to come to Britain for a whole host of reasons that make us a fantastic country. And that is a good thing. And it's going back to what I said about Birmingham, it's perfectly possible to say, yes, we have immigration control, but you are most welcome and you are contributing enormously to our society and all of those things. If you say, right, we have a decision to make about migration, you then turn the whole thing on its head because farmers will say, as they used to say to me when I was the Environment Secretary, every year, Hilary, you must persuade the Home Office to keep the seasonal agricultural workers scheme going because without it, there'll be no one to pick the vegetables and the fruit. And so you take a decision on the basis of the needs of industry. When people say, well, I'm afraid we're having to cancel operations because we haven't got enough nurses, even though we're trying to train more nurses in Britain, you have a different national debate about should we issue visas for nurses to come in and doctors? Because people say, well, yeah, that helps me meet a need. 1 in 5 of our care workers come from outside the United Kingdom at the moment. When my dad was dying, the people who came to care for him, almost all of them had either been born outside the United Kingdom or their parents had been. Who is going to look after us as we're older? Growing number of elderly people. We're going to have a need for care workers. And it seems to me in those circumstances, you have a conversation as a country and a society about the needs of sectors, of the economy, public services and so on, and it changes the nature of the debate because government can then say, right, we've had the debate, you want this, this is the number that we think is appropriate to make it work. And people think, well, at least we're having some decision over the process as opposed to none. Now, what numbers that will result in the end? Well, the choices made in all of those sectors will be added up and produce the number. But it's a different way of looking at it, and I think it's one that I think it's a message that the 52% sent in large measure, because migration and immigration was unquestionably the single biggest issue amongst the people who voted to leave. And if we can work the system out in that way, then I think we'll continue to get the benefit of migration, but the nation will be, the 52% will be more at ease with what is going on than they have been thus far. And that's why I made the point in an answer to the earlier question. We do need to understand why the 52% took the view that they did, but we absolutely also have to hear and reflect the views of the 48%. This is very, very, very important, because they feel angry, cross, and pessimistic about the future, and the 52% are optimistic about the future. You've replaced Remain and Leave with pessimism and optimism about the country. And we have to find a way of bringing people together. That's why all the debates about access to the market, customs union, cooperation, those are fears and concerns that the 48% have got, which we can, in the right deal, see reflected, while also respecting the 52% by leaving the institutions of the European Union, which is what's going to happen.
Thank you. Thank you all very much for coming. Thank you for the excellent questions. Please do follow the publications and comments of our excellent, hard-hitting Brexit team online. And can you join me in thanking Hilary Benn?